In the latest installment of the Our Path Forward series, we'll hear from Dr. Daina Ramey, Associate Professor in History and African Diaspora Studies at the University of Texas at Austin. Her book, The Price for Their Pound of Flesh, is the first book to explore the economic value of enslaved people through every phase of their lives, including from before birth to after death in the American domestic slave trade.
To this library, and this library is such a wonderful place to do this, and as a part of the On the Path Forward series, these discussions have been important opportunities for us to come together to dig down into our collective past, to allow us to work our way through a better understanding of who we are, where we are, why we are, and a little bit about what we must and need to do. Ultimately, that's what all discussions of our history should be achieving. It is one of the reasons why I am so fascinated by the work of Dr. Berry. In her work, Dr. Berry has honed in on one of the most difficult, dark, but important chapters of the American experience. An important part of the American experience. She has done the investigations, the explorations of the African diaspora. She's examined how that helped shape a young nation and how the reverberations of that era continue to impact modern American society. And her latest work, The Price for the Pound of Flesh, says so much in its very title. It goes in depth on the discussion about how men and women and children who were bought and sold as a part of the slave trade were dehumanized, commodified, and how they were looked at purely in terms of their value as property. Analogous to today's Americans might look at a tractor or a subway car or a laptop computer. This book really resonated with me, particularly because as someone who has done their own family history, I remember finding my great-great-grandfather's grandmother, and she was listed in a slave document, and her value was $700. And her son, which is my great-great-grandfather, was $75 because he was 1 year old. And so this book just really brought that home for me, the commodification of African-Americans. Yet we know these individuals who were bought, sold, and forced to work without compensation had hearts and souls and minds and hopes and dreams and loves and aspirations and triumphs, in spite of the nightmare situation they were forced to endure. If you read some of the stories that Dr. Berry talks about, he talks of with some of these interviews I thought were just stunning stories of America. In looking at this story, we are reminded of the banality of evil when a society turns a collective blind eye towards institutionalized, unconscionable acts. But we must also remind ourselves of the indomitable strength of the human spirit, and how those who were enslaved in this nation, first century, refused to be diminished or spiritually broken. In contemporary America, one of the things we often encounter is reluctance, a hesitation in addressing what former President Obama once called America's original sin. And to a large extent, we understand why that is. The concept that has animated the United States from its very beginning, in the notion that this is a nation built upon self-governance, equality, and meritocracy, has set us apart from another and other countries that have come before. We are a nation that has been built on themes of unity, of striving, of self-determination, and there is a mobility in those concepts, and a nobility that has been instilled generation after generation after generation of American pride, and rightfully so. So how can we square with a noble foundation that has proud national DNA with the reality that this was, in its earliest iterations, also a country in which slavery was allowed to flourish. How do we honor this country? How do we honor those ideals while acknowledging the failings? And how do we make sense of the deep divisions and conflicts that have been produced by these discrepancies for over the past two decades? Historians like Dr. Ramey Berry help us work through these questions by asking us to take a long, sober, and honest look at our national history. They help us better comprehend the central conflicts in our nation's past and how they came to be and how they continue to play out and influence our modern day society. Ultimately, historians like Dr. Ramey Berry help us to learn how to better understand our shared story, how to better visualize and conceptualize the different strands woven into the national fabric, and how to see ourselves more clearly. Through her continued, inquisitive, incisive work, Dr. Ramey Berry helps us gain a better sense of what it means to be living in the United States in 2017. She helps us develop a deeper appreciation of how we reached this moment in time and how she helps ground us, so many, to walk more deliberately toward our collective future. So I am pleased and honored to welcome her to our city. I want to thank Maria McCauley and her entire staff, and we have to congratulate Maria, she just had a baby, otherwise she'd be here, for working hard to bring Dr. Berry here. And let me tell you a little bit about her, and then I want you to join me in bringing her to the stage. Dr. Ramey Berry is the Associate Professor of the Department of History and African History and the African Diaspora Studies at the University of Texas at Austin. Her book, The Price of Their Pound of Flesh, explores the economic value of enslaved people through every phase of their lives, including from birth to after death in the American domestic slave trade. I am so very pleased to have her with us this evening. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ramey.
Thank you so much for the lovely introduction. It's an honor and a pleasure for me to be here. I wanted to thank both the mayor and the city manager and the staff here at the library for letting me come and talk about this life work of mine that I've been doing for the last 10 years. I'm going to talk a little bit about the process throughout, and I'm happy to talk more in Q&A and share some of my research stories with you all. I'm also going to read short sections of it to make points so that you can hear a little bit about the writing style. I don't always assume that everybody that's here has read the book, so that's sort of to whet your appetite. And also to just say that I've been speaking about this book since January, all over the country, and I've had a myriad of different types of responses, and for some people it's an emotional response. And I just want to say I respect how any of you in this audience receive this work, and I thank you for your time. So I want to talk a little bit about the beginning of the project and how I came up with this. This project is a six-chapter study, and it actually grew out of my first book, which was called Swing the Sickle for the Harvest is Ripe, Gender and Slavery in Antebellum Georgia, which was my tenure book. It was a book that I wrote that had been my dissertation that I turned into a book that was written for an academic audience. This particular book, The Price for the Pound of Flesh, is written for the public, and I've always had a large pulling or yearning in myself to make sure that I'm speaking to public audiences and not just the 20 or so academics that are interested in the aspect of slavery that I write about. And there's probably more than 20. And so I wanted to write a book that was accessible, and I was hoping it would be a book that anybody could read at any age level, any grade level. And because it took 10 years, because it changed directions, because when it was chapter 6 of Swing the Sickle, I had found 8 different plantations and 800 individual enslaved people, 12 plantations, on St. Simon's Island. And the value of enslaved people in those particular plantations, women during their childbearing years had higher values. And I kept thinking, I've been reading about slavery for 20 years, I've been teaching this history, I've been to archives all over the United States and even in parts of the Caribbean, and I'd never heard that women were valued more than men. And I'd never heard, you know, much about women's prices, period. Women's price patterns or the values, as I argue. And so I was writing that, I put it in the book, and the editor said, you know, I think this is a separate project. and I think you should pursue that somewhere else. And so it's great timing because I was going up for tenure and I needed a second book project. So that's how The Price for the Pound of Flesh sort of was born. I struggled for years to figure out how to structure the book. I had these increments based on age, based on, you know, time period. I had different periods of time to look at the book. And then I decided, and I came across this arc of looking at it across the stages of life. So looking at the human body's life cycle. And that's when I knew I was on to something. So the chapters are structured based on different stages of life from before people are born, before they're conceived, and because they were valued before they were born. The status of a slave was defined by their mothers. So if their mothers were enslaved, then they too would be enslaved. So they would make projections off about the fertility and the health of potential children that women would give birth to. And so I was trying to understand how do I contextualize that. And then they were priced throughout their whole life, and we'll talk about the values after death, which I call ghost values. So here I have to always honor and thank a scholar that some of you may are familiar with, a gentleman by the name of Stanley Ingerman, who wrote with Robert Fogel, Time on the Cross in the 1970s, which was a very controversial study that looked at the economics of slavery and did things like the average number of times an enslaved person was whipped was 7 times. A lot of statistics, charts, graphs, but the people were missing from that. And so there was large controversy, numbers of debates and discussions about their research. But they had done about 20 years of research all over the South and using probate records that had the value of enslaved people based on appraisal values and sale values. I was fortunate when I was working on The Price for the Pound of Flesh and giving a talk, and this is when I was struggling to find out what my focus was going to be and how I was going to structure the book. I gave a talk at Duke University for some political science and economic scholars. And I was supposed to write about slave prices, but as I was working on that particular article, I kept coming across the ways in which enslaved people were expressing their thoughts about values. And it wasn't just monetary values, it was the values that they had as human beings. And I decided to write a paper on enslaved people who committed suicide the night before they were going to be sold. And I tried to contextualize like why they did this, what they said, if I had evidence. A lot of this came from court records where people were suing because a person wasn't delivered up. So then they would sue them because the person died the day before the transaction was going to take place. And after I finished the talk, he came up to me and he said, you know, I've been waiting for 30 years for someone to write this book. He said, you are writing a book? And I said, yes. And he said, I think I might have something that will help you. Do you have time to come to the University of Rochester and come to my house and my office? And I said, sure. I mean, I'm not going to turn that opportunity down. And it was then that he donated about 60,000 cases from their research from Time on the Cross. And that really sort of catapulted my research because I had been going all over the South. And at that point, I think I had maybe 7,000 or 6,000 individual enslaved values, the name, the age, the sex, the state, the county, if I had their eye color, shoe size, any type of biological information, and put this in an Excel chart. He gave me the raw data that they used for Time on the Cross. And I spent the next 3 or 4 years going back and forth with this data set and trying to figure out which ones were appraisal values, which ones were sale values. I also discovered 4,000 life insurance records from an archive. This was in 2004, and I knew I had found a gold mine. I just said, I'm going to hold on to this until it's time to write about it. And that company is still around today. So at the end of my talk, we'll talk about some contemporary connections to slavery because it's not that far away. So the book used all this data, and I think by the time I cleaned it up and took out my stuff, made sure there was not any overlap, I think the end number that I used for the manuscript was about 55,000 to 60,000 cases. So each chapter is based on about 10,000 to 15,000 figures. And while I was writing, once again, I was more interested in the people and their voices. And so I ended up writing a book that dealt more with them. I'm going to show you this chart, because this is about the extent of what you're going to see in my book, about the numbers and about the data. This data I've compiled on a slide, but it's at the top of every chapter. And the first number that's there, that you see here, is the value during that time of $1,860. And this is the average appraisal value of males. And then this is the average appraisal value of females between the ages of 0 and 10. The second number in the parentheses is the value of that person in 2014. And I chose the lowest income value ratio. There's a wider range, but I chose the lowest one so that I didn't get accused of being making this inflation to make it a shock value. So I chose the lowest number. And in these areas over here, looking at 14,000 and 15,000, depending on what type of chart and conversion records you're using, could be as large as $100,000 and $120,000. So enslaved people were very expensive, and they were an expensive investment. Think about people that own 20, 30, 50 enslaved people. That tells you a lot about how much money they have in their property. So this is one of the types of documents I used in the book. I used any type of record that had a dollar sign or shillings, pounds, what have you, whether it was British currency. It had information about a person, but I always needed age data because I was looking at name, age, sex, and price. So if they didn't have age data, they're not included in the data set that I used. This is just a bill of sale. This is on the eve of the Civil War. I ended up taking out Civil War data, and I'll tell you why later, of a 32-year-old man. By the name of Sam, and they refer to Sam, who's 32, as a Negro boy, which I thought was interesting. He was 5 feet, about 5 feet, 6 feet tall, and he was a dark complexion. He weighed about 175 pounds, and he was a skilled brick maker. So these are just an example. These are examples of the types of documents, and this is just one, because I have a lot I want to cover tonight. But this is just one example of the kind of records that I use in this book. So now I'm going to read a little bit, just a section. And this is really starting off with infancy and how do we understand the question I asked, the question that drove this work, was what did enslaved people think? What did they know? What did they feel? How did they make sense of themselves as commodities? Did they care about their values? Did they not care? What did they know and understand about themselves being traded in the auction world? And when did this knowledge come to them? In 1854, Rachel, an infant girl, was placed on the auction block. Although she was wrapped in a coverlet and she was asleep, her face was exposed. An enslaved man had delivered her to the auction on the instructions of his enslaver. Rachel was about a year old and she was for sale. As the enslaved man sat on the courthouse steps with Rachel, waiting for the noon hour, the time and place of many public auctions, one wonders how this enslaved man felt. Was it excruciating for him to carry out his enslaver's demand and bring little Rachel to the market? Or was he unmoved? What kind of exchange had he had with her parents? Did he feel partially responsible for what was about to take place? Imagine trying to keep the baby calm after she was separated from her mother and handing her over to the sheriff at the start of the auction. While the enslaved man sat holding Rachel in his arms, the Reverend Nehemiah Adams, a visitor from Boston on a 3-month tour of the South, approached him to ask a few questions. Adams was startled to see an enslaved man holding an infant. "Is the child sick?" Adams asked. Responding with deference, the enslaved man replied, "No, master, she's going to be sold." Puzzled, Adams inquired about the child's mother, to which the man answered, that she was at home. The minister's mind was filled with all kinds of questions, but most importantly, he worried about Rachel's mother. How did she feel? How much did she miss her child? Was the infant taken openly or secretly? Who did this? By now, Rachel was weeping and refusing to be comforted. This was too much for Adams, who chose not to stay and witness the sale. Later, he learned that Rachel had been sold for $140. Imagine her confusion as she looked at the group of potential buyers gazing at her, evaluating her earning potential. How did Rachel even begin to process what occurred? Her inconsolable crime is one clue, but she was too young to express her feelings in any other way. So I opened with infancy because this is the first space that I thought, how can I walk the reader through? How can we understand how enslaved people make sense? We don't have her voice, obviously. She's probably not at the age of speech yet. But how do we understand this, and what do we do with this, and how do enslaved people begin to make sense, and what age do they recognize themselves? I'm going to read to you now a little bit about a gentleman named Jordan. Many a man 50 years old had not seen and felt what I had before my 20th year. These are the words of Jordan H. Banks, who was born into slavery, sold three times, escaped twice, and ultimately reached freedom. His early years were pleasant compared to those as he matured into adulthood. In his narrative, which was published in 1861, we learn many things about the value of the enslaved and the ways enslavers, traders, and medical doctors trafficked human chattel from birth to death and beyond. Banks lived on a Virginia plantation with his parents and 16 siblings, which is pretty unique. His mother served as a cook, his father was a headman, and the family was intact. As a young child, he played with his enslaver son, Alexander, who was just 1 year older than he. By age 5, Banks began to realize that he and Alex were different when his playmate began beating him. Banks fought back because his father warned him that he had to respond or else suffer continued beatings. Embracing the spirit, Banks kept track of how many whippings he owed Alex, and he returned them blow for blow. Even in childhood, Banks' actions showed a nascent understanding of what I call his soul value, separate from his enslaver. As he processed the distinction between himself and his nemesis, Banks experienced another epiphany. Alex attended school while he was sent to, quote, scare crows in the fields. In his words, the dreary days of my boyhood began in the fields. This moment during enslaved childhood served as a turning point in Banks' understanding of the reality of his condition. Historian Wilma King refers to this as a quantum leap into the world of work. As they aged, enslaved youth and young adults learned and intimately understood their place in the world. Banks' maturation solidified his understanding of enslavement, especially during three pivotal events of his youth and early adulthood. The first was the sale of his two sisters. The second was a nearly fatal beating of his mother. And the third was, as he refers to, the slow death of his enslaver. Of the latter, Banks remarked, "I saw him in life, and I saw him in death, but he left me in chains." So here we have a child aged 5 or 6 that is understanding himself as a commodity, understanding himself differently from the child that he grew up playing with. I have images here of enslaved children playing with white children because they were often purchased to serve as playmates, or the term they used at the time was pets in their households. And in class, students were always asking me, you know, how did enslaved people understand? When did they know they were different? What happened to that relationship? They've been playing together all this time. How did this shift occur? And I was trying to look for moments where I could capture that, and moments during the records where enslaved people talked about it. And I felt like that story with Jordan was one example. So many enslaved children have vivid memories of the sale experience. Melita Plethy of Missouri recalled that when she was 9 or 10 years old, she was, quote, put up on the auction block and sold. Of the stand, she recalled, it was just a piece of cutout log and it stood on one end. Her recollection about her price, though, is even more telling. She says, they was offered $600, but my mistress cried so much that master didn't sell me. The mistress' attachment to her human property was so great in this case that the family decided not to sell Marlita. Such interventions were not always successful, or were they helpful. Several enslaved people reported that their mistresses were as violent and sadistic as their husbands. And there's a scholar, Stephanie Jones Rogers, out of UC Berkeley, who's writing a book from the perspective of enslaved people about their plantation mistresses. It'll be out next year with Yale University Press. So here we have that many of them report that their mistresses were abusive. In this case, though, we do not know whether or not Marlita preferred to remain with her mistress. All we know is that she was not sold, and that decades later, she remembered the monetary value she carried at the auction. It made a deep impression on her young mind. So this is just, again, places where they're mentioning this. When enslaved people were sold, often, not all enslavers, but some gave them a rating system that was based on the prime enslaved person between the ages of 18 and 30 years of age was a prime or A1 or first rate enslaved person, and other workers were marked below that. So that's how much work they could do in a given day. So there would be an A1 prime, and then be a 3/4 hand, a 1/2 hand, a 1/4 hand, and then someone had zero rating. And I found that those who kept track of their rates, those values were equivalent to the rating system had an equivalency with their monetary values. And so that was one place where I could really pull out and tease and understand where enslaved people were valued. And my overall findings are the same that, you know, U.B. Phillips wrote about in American Negro Slavery in 1918. He was one of the first scholars to write about slave prices. And then the work by Robert Fogel and Stan Engerman, they showed a bell curve where the values are increasing from birth up until, for women, about age 26 or 27, and then they start to decrease. And for men, between ages of 30 and 35. That's just a general pattern that I found. It's the same pattern that we've seen before. So there's no unique finding there, but I think what's different is that I'm trying to find a way for readers to think and hear and listen to the enslaved. The pubescent years were terrifying. Not only were their bodies changing, but this was also a time when enslaved children experienced a separation that they had feared all of their lives. That's assuming they had not experienced sale yet. Daughters and sons were taken from their parents as the external value of their bodies increased. Market scenes from their childhood now made sense and haunted them for the rest of their lives. At this stage in their maturation, they knew full well that others claimed ownership of them and that a sexual assault came at any age. However, their parents, if present, as well as other kin, reminded them of a value that enslavers and traders could not commodify, the spiritual value of their immortal selves, soul values, my term for such valuation. It often escaped calculation and developed during these years. Enriched through an inner spiritual centering that facilitated survival, soul values were reinforced by loved ones. Sometimes this internal value appeared as a spirit, a voice, a vision, a premonition, a sermon, an ancestor, or a god. It came in public and private settings and was occasionally described as a personal message from a higher being, a heaviness in the core of their bodies. My soul began singing, one enslaved person recalled, and I was told that I was one of the elected children. This telling, this uplifting, this singing of a fearful thrill, of things unknown but longed for still, made the enslaved feel free during captivity. Freedom of the soul matured during puberty. And so what I found as they were getting to this age where they understood themselves, they were fighting back against enslavement by clinging on to a piece of themselves that could not be commodified. And that's what I'm calling the soul value. And they also started coming up with differences about the way they thought about their values and about what it means to be rated, what it means to be called a first-rate bargain, what it means to be A1 prime, and so forth, and they talked about it. And a lot of the examples, many of the examples in this book, come from runaway enslaved people who successfully made it to Canada or to the North. And I always have to say, as a disclaimer, that it makes it seem like escape was something that was easy and easily accessible, and it wasn't. I think it's just rare we have the testimony because abolitionists in the North and other parts of the US publish these narratives. So a lot of the material I have comes from narratives of those that escaped to Canada, but I don't want you to assume that that was something that was easy to do. So there's an enslaved man that talks about what it means to be an enslaved person. And he says, as soon as I came to the age of maturity and could think for myself, Thomas Likers explained, I came to the conclusion that God never meant for me a slave, and that I should be a fool if I didn't take my liberty the first chance that I got. So you see expressions to me of their soul values found in running away, found in them trying to create a life of their own. From Canada, Benjamin Miller explained what first rate meant to the enslaved. Before his escape from his North Carolina enslaver, who had trusted him to travel to and from to the market, run errands, or do favors, Benjamin Miller talked to his owner about getting, being able to purchase himself, which is also, self-purchase occurred, but it wasn't the primary avenue that enslaved people received their freedom. So he collected small amounts of money over the years and had negotiated a price to buy himself from his enslaver. And he says that even his owner gave him these small amounts of money, but I was still a slave, he explained. On one occasion, Miller was going to purchase himself for the negotiated rate of $450. But neighbors told his enslaver that he was a fool to sell him for $450, and he might be able to get me for $800. This is him describing this. This is Benjamin Miller. When his enslaver raised the price to $500, Miller was unwilling to pay it. Instead, he fled without paying and made his way to Canada. Reflecting on this pivotal event, Miller discussed what it meant to be first rate. He says, I have done first rate here. I will tell you what I call first rate. I call first rate from the fact that we have to row against the wind and tide and we get here. And being brought up illiterate, I consider that if we live and keep our families well fed and clad, we have done first rate. And so there's just a difference in the way in which the commodification of their bodies is something external to them. And I think they were able to separate themselves from that. Walter Johnson from Harvard University argues in Soul by Soul that their children were raised to know themselves as both human beings, people, and as commodities, and they could separate themselves from that. Throughout the book, as they age, I've found more and more expressions of soul value. One of them is my favorite, Mingo, who was a poet, and he was separated from his wife and his two children, and because of that, he ran away, because he could not imagine living without his family. And he was imprisoned, and the evening before he tried to escape again, he wrote a poem on the beam of the prison wall. And I'm not going to read the whole poem, but I'll read you the piece of this poem that sort of carried through my writing process. He says to his wife, "Dear wife, they cannot sell the rose of love that in my bosom glows. Remember, as your tears may start, they cannot sell thy immortal part." And he goes on, it's beautiful, and he talks to her and gives her hope about a place beyond where they are, about a place beyond the here and now. And I thought, to me, that Mingo really expressed his soul value. He ends up escaping that night from the prison, and he was later killed by bloodhounds. And I hope to think, for my own self being optimistic, we know later that his wife, when they talked to his wife at some point, there was an article in a newspaper about this, that she had a collection of his poems. So I like to believe and hope that maybe she read that last poem that was translated and published in a local newspaper, and that maybe she heard his final words to her. My favorite enslaved person is a gentleman named Isaac, who's in chapter 5, because what I did with this book is I didn't just look at enslaved males that were in their prime years for their values, which most studies on enslaved people's values or prices look at prime males. I looked at people before age 14 and after age 40, which is 40 is considered elderly during slavery. And so Mingo is in chapter 5, which deals with people that are, Isaac is in chapter 5, and he's dealing with people that are over 40 years old. Isaac was captured for planning a rebellion, so it was a conspiracy, it never happened. And he was taken in, and he was imprisoned, and they were asking him who else was involved with this particular uprising that they were planning. And he said, "Take me, I'm the only one. Don't take anyone else, just take me." And they said, "Well, we need to know if there's other people involved. You know, we've rounded up a bunch of other African-American men that we think are guilty." And he's like, "I'm the one, take me." And so he'd been in this community and was well-respected, and his minister, who had baptized him, came to speak with him that night. And they had a four-hour conversation while he was in jail. And during that conversation, they prayed, they talked, and the minister said that he felt like he was a guilty one. And he felt like, because Isaac says to him, "Aren't you the God? You know, God is a God of the black and the white. You know, you're no better than me. And why do I have to work for you without being paid?" And the minister said, "Well, don't you love us? We've converted you, we've brought you to God." And you know, he said, "I love you and I love Master." He said, "But if I had my chance, I would kill the two of you first," he said, "in order to be free." He said, "So if you can take anybody's life, just take mine. Don't just spare the others." The next day comes, the minister is so moved, he leaves the after they do a long prayer together, and they were both crying apparently. The minister couldn't even show up for the hanging the next day. They're out there, Isaac is there, there's five or six others, and one of those persons is his brother. They have the noose around Isaac's neck, and they say, you know, here's your chance for final words, you know, is there anything you'd like to say? And he said, I would die a noble death if you just take me. And then he looked at his brother and the other gentlemen that were standing there, and he said, be men and die like men. Before they could pull the hatch which lowered the floor, he jumped, lifted up his legs, and hung himself. And to me, that is the strongest example of soul value. He chose when his life was going to end, how it was going to end, and he had control over that. Right after that, the other men that were there did the exact same thing. When it was, they were had their noose around, they jumped to their own deaths, and they said, be men and die like men, and they all died. After Isaac was laid to rest, there was his wife and his five children, who went and then made a gravesite for him. And they said that, this description says that he found there was rocks and stones that no one in that community had ever seen. And there was always fresh flowers out there every single day until the day that she passed. And so I think that just shows something here that shows them dying the way that they wanted to die and honoring their loved ones the way they wanted to honor them. And I want to close out with just a few more points. When they thought about life after death or at death, Elizabeth Keckley says, former slave Elizabeth Keckley, at the grave, at least we should be permitted to lay our burdens down to a new world. A world of brightness may open up to us. The light that is denied us here should grow into a flood of effluence beyond the dark, mysterious shadows of death. And a descendant of Nat Turner says about death, she says, this is Lucy Turner, she says, sometimes there is a victory in the grave which leads to a bright eternal heaven where faith, hope, charity, love, and justice shall last forever and ever without ceasing. So this is just some evidence of what enslaved people thought about the afterlife or what they thought death meant. And when I was writing about 3 or 4 years before the book was finished, this is how I wanted to end the book. I was looking for research on enslaved burials, burial grounds, what kind of ceremonies they had, whether they had African traditions and different, what kinds of things that they said, did they wear, were they buried with. And I spent a lot of time doing research on that. And because I was also tracing bodies and looking at the trade, I found a narrative of an enslaved man who was asked by his owner to go get, exhume the body of a 2-year-old and bring it to him. And I thought, okay, I've been reading about this history for a long time, I've never seen this, why are they exhuming this body? And he says, I know that the doctor, he's gonna send it to a doctor in Virginia, and then they're gonna cut it up into pieces. I thought, wait a minute, what is this? Todd Savitt wrote a book called Medicine and Slavery. Harriet Washington did medical apartheid. And Michael Sappel also wrote a book called A Traffic in Dead Bodies. What I discovered at this point, and after talking to some of these scholars, that there was a trade in cadavers. And there was a trade in enslaved cadavers. But I was not just, this was a trade that I call the domestic cadaver trade. And I actually added 3 more years of research on to try to understand how this traffic occurred, how was it structured, who was involved. And what I learned was that a lot of the medical schools here in the North and Northeast had purchased enslaved men to serve as grave robbers, resurrection men. And they hired them, they purchased them, and then had them go take bodies, exhume bodies. Now, for medical education research at medical schools for anatomical dissection. And I have to say, though, that the bodies that were taken were majority African American. They were not all enslaved, but I was interested in trying to find and identify those that had been formerly enslaved. That was looking at a needle in a haystack, as those scholars told me when I went about it. And it was, but I did find them in the anatomy records of physicians at many major medical schools. So what did they do? They took, if they were looking for obituaries, so those meant they were probably free blacks, but any unclaimed bodies, poor, indigenous people, people that were not claimed, that were in almshouses, prisons, and no one came to claim their bodies, those were the bodies that were then sent to medical schools. But when they were doing it illegally, they would go steal a body, put it in a bag such as this, and cart them off to the medical school. There was an elaborate traffic of this. This is an image of, a very disturbing image of an outdoor dissection at the University of North Carolina with a black male body with his head cut open and a black male janitor here. And these are the individuals that I've studied for about 3 years to try to understand how they got to these schools and how they did this work. This image is taken after slavery, but we do know from other scholars that have done work in this area, and there's a book called Dissection that was published here. I think it was Harvard Medical School published it. And that showed all these dissection photographs, and many of these photographs are African-American janitors. So I wanted to understand this history. Resurrection Man, as I mentioned, also known as Graveyard Man, were also appeared in the pictures of the medical school class photos. They were very well respected by the medical community, by the students at the medical schools. And this gentleman here is Grandison Harris from the Medical College of Georgia. The faculty members invested in him by purchasing him from a South Carolina auction block and dividing up his body while he was alive into 7 shares. And whenever someone left the university, they could sell 1/7 the share of Grandison's value when they left the school. So he was enslaved by them and he worked for them. And he was all over the records for the school. I would say 25% of the records, Grandison's name is in the account books for this particular medical school. Some of you may know that in the 1980s, Bones in My Basement by Blakely, they discovered the bones that were there, and they think that some of these bodies were the bodies that Grandison Harris had collected. When they had to travel further distances, they put them in whiskey casks, and they were shipped along the same steamboats and ships as the domestic slave trade, sometimes on the same ships that live enslaved bodies were on at that time. And it's a market and a traffic that I think we're just at the beginning of learning about. And I think I had the tip of the iceberg, and there's so much more to do. I'm hoping that graduate students go down this and look for more about this. This is another the resurrection man, Chris Baker, who was actually born at the Medical College of Virginia. And his father had been the graveyard man before him. And he stayed there all of his life. And I'm interested in learning more about them. They had wives and children that also worked in the dissection room as well. Chris Baker was still at the university even after, in 1896. There was a fight over a body of a black man who was accused of murder, and the family was fighting to get the body back, and they used Chris Baker to figure out how they were going to transport the body. So even after slavery, he was still being utilized for that work. And one of the things I found ironic was that you don't find many obituaries on formerly enslaved people, but people like Grandison Harris, Chris Baker, and some of the others that I write about have scholarships in their names. The school has them in the catalogs and special commemorative programs honoring them. I found this obituary after I finished the book of Chris Baker, but they had a funeral for him. And a lot of medical students, there's poems written for him in his honor. So they were very, very well respected. You can imagine that within the black community, they were not. They were feared and disliked. People paid money to come to the public dissections. These are some anatomy lecture tickets. And I came across this research really in the 1880s when some of these gentlemen like Chris Baker were caught for body snatching, working with anatomy professors. And I sort of moved backwards into the history, and that's how I found it. So I'm going to show you the records from the 1880s first, and then we'll talk a little about the slave records, and I'm going to wrap up so we can have time for Q&A. So this is evidence of body snatching in a scrapbook from 1882, and it talks about their bodies and they're trying to trade. So the same way that we read records from the domestic slave trade, where people are saying, well, we're selling boys age 10 or 12 in our market, what do you have at your market? You're seeing the same thing for the cadaver trade. And sometimes they identify the body as Negro, and sometimes they don't. And this is the beginning of the Pennsylvania Anatomy Act to then regulate this so that make sure that schools are getting bodies properly and not illegally, and that schools are being distributed bodies enough so that people can have the right amount of sources for the dissection for that medical class. Some more list of bodies. It's kind of a bad quality copy, but you can see that they're listing the bodies. And they're listing them even more. This is the 1880s. And then finally, it becomes regulated with anatomical review board records. And these are the records now that they're still using these types of records to keep track. And you'll see you can't really read it from there, but sometimes it says whether or not the body's been cut, has it been claimed, has it been buried or not. And I think the fact that they have to ask that question tells you something about how common this trade was So I ended up tracing the remains of a very famous person, and I'll talk about that as I close. But I want to say that because I was interested in burials for so long, they decided in 1998 to bury the remains that were found at the Medical College of Georgia. And these are the bodies that Grandison Harris had been working with. And the last line on here says, "May they rest in eternal peace." They were put in a 2,500-pound vault that was sealed so that it could not be opened and their slumber would not be disturbed. While I was writing the book, I was tracing, I found Nat Turner's skull in some medical records of a number of schools where they were saying that this is the skull of a Negro named Nat Turner who led an unsuccessful revolt in Virginia. I thought that was interesting. Supposedly that was inscribed across his head. So I wrote a piece about it, and I wasn't writing it to have people send me things like this, because afterwards people said, "Oh, well, you know, my father was a medical doctor, my grandfather was, and we have some of these relics, and we don't know what to do with it." I had a student in my class at UT Austin that I was telling the story about Nat Turner's skull and how there was this trade in these bodies, and some of the students were looking at me side-eyed, like, "What is she talking about? You know, she can't be serious." And I had a brave student raise his hand. He said, "Well, I have to say that I come from four generations of medical doctors, and we have a purse made out of human skin." And that was like the end of the lecture for that day, and it really drove it home. So there is still a trade, and you know there's a trade in body parts, there's a trade in kidneys, and you know there's an illegal trade that's still happening today. And the human remains that were found at Virginia Commonwealth University, which is where Chris Baker used to work, have been discovered, and they've studied them, and they're going back and forth about they're trying to determine how they want to lay them to rest, what kind of ceremony they want to have. They have not been buried yet, but they found the tags and identification information on there. So we're still done with this legacy. It's not a legacy that's, you know, we think that slavery ended in 1865, but we still have relics and body parts and souls that need to be buried. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.